So with Azure applications, it all starts with Azure Resource Manager. Azure Resource Manager is the universal control plane for all Azure services. You can see here a kind of architecture diagram of Azure Resource Manager, ARM. That top layer there is a REST API. And talking to that REST API, you've got the Azure portal, you've got CLI and PowerShell, you've got SDKs. But underneath that REST API are what are called resource providers. So ARM is really a front door, and the resource providers provide all of the service-specific control plane operations and actions. You can see a whole bunch of them there just shown as examples. But what ARM provides by being a universal control plane is that it manages resource metadata, groups of resources into resource groups, manages subscriptions, management groups for policy, tags that you can assign to the resources. It keeps track of those things. It implements role-based access control across the whole thing, and it keeps activity logs and telemetry about all of the activities on the control plane. So this means that you get the same capabilities for management, monitoring, policy across all Azure resources uniformly. Now, one of the challenges with Azure Resource Manager is you can, of course, interact with it imperatively just by calling the REST API or performing one-off actions in the CLI or PowerShell or the portal. But where the true value and power of ARM comes is with declarative deployments through Azure Resource Manager JSON templates. Now, the JSON templates themselves are fairly verbose, and that's just kind of a side effect of the JSON language and the fact that we have to represent all these properties in JSON. And the verbosity and the use of certain primitives like expressions have made it very cumbersome and complicated to write anything more than simple resource deployments using the ARM JSON. We've done a lot of improvements in the tooling with Visual Studio Code plugins and IntelliSense that make it a lot easier, and the kind of pre-deployment checks that we do. But still, we thought we could take things much further. And that much further is with a domain-specific language that is mapped directly conceptually, one-to-one to ARM. Now you might be saying, why didn't you pick a language off the shelf? Well, ARM and our philosophy is declarative in nature. So we needed a language that's declarative, not imperative. We don't want Turing-complete machines here in the sense that we could run loops and you end up basically with scripts. Scripts are a path towards amazing levels of complexity. And so we want the system to be able to do hard work for you, and that means declarative deployments, and that also means much easier to understand. So this required us to really look at a declarative language that really treats the ARM JSON as an intermediate syntax, like an assembly language. You can go right to the assembly language, but you can also start with this higher level abstraction, the Bicep project, which is completely open source. You can contribute to it, you can make comments to it. And what I thought was is show you a little bit of what Bicep aims to do in this intermediate form so that you can get engaged early. And it's not near a V1.0 release, but this kind of shows you where we're going. We've done many, many interviews with customers. We've got many customers that are in pilot helping us design this. And we've even got Anders Heilsberg, one of the foremost language designers on the planet who is working on TypeScript, borrowed him to give us advice on how to construct this language. So let's go take a look at Project Bicep in action. So here you can see I've got a Bicep file that describes the deployment of a virtual machine. And you'll notice already that it's a lot more concise than a JSON equivalent that you'll see in an ARM template traditionally in a few minutes. For example, you can see that we've got parameters that we define like we would with any kind of program up at the top, where these are the configuration settings that can come in from another file. They'll include, for example, the admin username and the admin password, or the Windows OS version, the allowed properties that we've got for the virtual machines that we're going to be deploying. You can also see, as we scroll down a little bit, the different resources that we're creating, including, for example, the storage account that is going to be where the disks are stored for the virtual machine. You can see the the public IP address, you can see the network security group, and the properties. Again, much more concise than traditional JSON. You can see the NIC, you can see now the virtual network itself, a virtual machine itself rather. Now when I compile this with using the Bicep compiler command line utility, it compiles it down to standard ARM JSON, which I'm going to load side by side, and you can kind of see now directly comparing the two, the savings that we get with the simplicity. Like, we don't have to quote all the properties like we do in JSON. But there's some other benefits that you get right off the bat. For example, you can see right here the storage account name. We use this kind of very concise way to create a unique name based off of the resource group address, which is dynamically generated at deployment time. And you can see that that gets translated to the more verbose kind of awkward format that you would have to deal with if you were dealing directly with the ARM JSON. Similarly, if we scroll down a little bit, you can see the virtual network, which has got a virtual security group attached to it, a subnet within it. The same kind of more concise syntax that you get. But where it really shines is in, if you take a look at the way that we labeled the resource group, the resources by name, we can reference them directly. Instead of specifying the full ARM IDs, we simply reference the names. And Bicep takes care of expanding. So here's security group ID, and you can see that expands as we recompile into the appropriate ARM ID. Not only that, but it sees that we created a reference to that security group ID, so it knows we also depend on it. So it created automatically the depends on command inside of that resource definition for us. And you reference that same security ID. So you get just here a flavor, and here I'll go deploy that JSON template, and it's going to deploy just like any other. But with Bicep, and this is just the first step of some of the benefits you're going to get, you're going to see much more come online over the next few months, where Bicep is just, we believe, going to become the main way that people author templates for ARM. But another project is looking not at the way you deploy applications, but the way that you author them. And when we take a look at the state of cloud native development today, it really is kind of a hodgepodge mix of technologies. And so if you take a look at the typical enterprise developer that wants to create a microservice-based application that might have stateless functions as a service application portion, a portion that is kind of more stateful and could leverage the actor model, the virtual actor model, one that just consists of intermediate microservices, and they want to integrate those with other services like PubSub, like state management. Really, it is learning 15 different SDKs, multiple different programming model styles, being locked into specific languages because functions might only support some languages, not other ones. Same thing with actor model. So right now, it's a very complex landscape to navigate for somebody that is coming from client web database kind of multi-tier applications and programs in the language of their choice at the company, which is standardized on language and tooling of certain and runtimes of certain types. Dapper is aimed at simplifying the lives of enterprise developers by providing you a common substrate of capabilities that you can take advantage of a la carte to be able to integrate with other services, PubSub, state, stores, triggers, service-to-service invocation, regardless of what language you're programming in, regardless of what runtimes you leverage, and regardless of where you want to run, whether the cloud, on-prem, on a single server, or on a cluster. The way that it does this is by providing these abstractions through an HTTP or gRPC endpoint as a sidecar interface. So your application simply calls into Dapper, and Dapper takes care of the rest, hence kind of the butler analogy with Dapper. It takes care of, hey, I want to call this other service named bar, go call it. And Dapper takes care of your command that you pass in through HTTP REST or gRPC and forwards the message on reliably, durably, and scalably to the target service, regardless of where it happens to be operating. It's optimized for Kubernetes clusters since that's many of the deployments, but you can install it as a self-hosted model on your own server. It's got over 76 different bindings, meaning you Kafka and RabbitMQ and event hubs and services for like DynamoDB from other clouds that you can then leverage through this abstract interface and take advantage of these capabilities. So no longer do you have to learn 15 different SDKs. You get portability because you can take the same app, run it on one cloud, and then move it to another cloud or move it to on-prem. And now you can focus on your business logic, take advantage of functions as a service model or actor model, or just long-running microservice model, and Dapper takes care of the rest. Again, bring whatever code you want, incrementally adopt it, or go wholesale. Really, there's no, it doesn't force you into any particular point of view. Let's go see Dapper in action, because that's kind of the easiest way to see the kind of value it provides. And in this demo, what I'm going to show you is how it creates a substrate across different Azure services that might be running on a Kubernetes cluster through an application that we'll look at end to end. So this application is a Shopify shopping cart type application, which is going to take online orders and cancellations for orders through API management, or an Azure service, running on a Kubernetes cluster, leverage a Logic Apps workflow, also running on that Kubernetes cluster, that will send messages through a service bus to an Azure function auditor. It's also, the Logic App is also going to call into Cosmos DB, and it's also going to use another service bus queue to write messages to a dashboard that we can look at the status of order cancellation. And finally, it's going to use Twilio SendGrid to send email messages about the cancellation. All of this is going to be built and monitored through Application Insights, leveraging Dapper. So let's take a look first here, a Logic App that is leveraging Dapper like we talked about before. So you can see right here that when the cancellation comes in, Logic Apps is calling out to Service Bus and to the Workflow Store using these Dapper URLs there by REST APIs against the local Dapper endpoint, localhost 3500. You can see it's also calling into Twilio SendGrid here to send that email cancellation email with the body of the text. All of this is orchestrated through the workflow and Logic Apps. And then you can see here at the Azure function, the auditor function here, also getting triggered through Dapper, and then it is also going to send and record that here in the state store, which, as we mentioned earlier, is going to be Redis cache underneath, but that's abstracted from the developer. They're simply saying, hey, save this in the state store, which can be late bound. So we can leverage Redis cache on the edge here on this Kubernetes cluster, or we could leverage Cosmos DB or DynamoDB, depending on where we would run it. And you can see right here is where we're specifying the fact that the state store is Redis. Now, when we deploy this, you can see here's the Azure function where we've got some annotations here. So when we deploy it, we want Dapper tracing to be turned on. So this is going to be what's collected through App Insights. Here's the API management configuration. And you can see we just sent the cancellation here in. And then finally, Dapper plus App Services here. Here's the dashboard that is also leveraging Service Bus through Dapper integration, which is going to be showing us that the order was canceled, and that's confirmed. Here's the email that we've received, finally confirming it. And then here's the Application Insights view, so we get a full end-to-end view automatically without having to do any instrumentation inside of the application code of all these different interactions together. And so we can see the performance. We can see exactly how those messages from that order cancellation propagated through all those different Dapper-enabled microservices. So you can think of Dapper as kind of an application mesh or substrate, but for lower level programming and for infrastructure level monitoring and control of message routing, service meshes are popular. Service meshes specifically for Kubernetes. And one of the areas that Microsoft led was the standardization of Service Mesh Interface, or SMI, which allows you to plug in different service mesh technologies into a common interface such that a system that implements SMI, you can plug in different service meshes as needed. We've decided to implement our own service mesh to meet the needs of our Azure customers in the best way possible. So this service mesh is standardized, simplified, open source. It's going to support basic features at the start and expand over time, supporting things like traffic management, mutual auth TLS, fault injection, and load balancing are just some of the services that are provided by service mesh, and specifically the open service mesh implementation and specification that matches SMI that we're bringing to market. And so this is also something that's completely open source. Recommend you go to GitHub open service mesh, and you can issue your own pull requests or see what's going on underneath the hood. At the core of it is an Envoy sidecar container that routes the traffic from the user's pod. So as you're talking, your applications are talking over the network, that's being intercepted by the Envoy sidecar container that can then forward traffic, block it, route it, authenticate it, and secure it. So that's a quick look at some of the work that we're doing in the area of programming models and supporting the infrastructure for managing applications.